Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I yield myself such time as I may consume.
Gentleman is recognized.
Look, when I became chairman of this committee, I vowed never to do this kind of a package. I thought that each bill deserved to be debated and to be moved as a standalone. Basically, we in the House did that. Unfortunately, the Senate did not, which is why there are at least 63 House-passed bills in this package, 62 of which were passed on suspension that have been sitting in the Senate languishing for up to a year and a half. If somebody says they don't have time to look at all the stuff that's in here, there have been months that have been able to look at this stuff as it's been sitting over in the Senate. Much of it is of parochial significance, which means it solves local challenges. The very basis of all the bills that are in here is to put people above government. If indeed we're going to have public lands, there should be access to those lands. That's one of the reasons why, for the first time in years, we've had some sportsmen's activities that are put into this particular bill. So the sportsmen can assume if they're on public land, it's going to be open for recreational hunting and fishing and shooting, and all manners of kind of outdoor recreation, unless it is specifically closed. And a land manager cannot be arbitrary with that. If they're going to close it, there has to be a public process to go through that mandates consultation with local officials. It is extremely important that bow hunters get some protection. Even duck hunters get some certainty in here. For the first time, we're going to have special days for duck hunting, for youth and veterans, as well as those who are on active duty. For the first time, there is real reforms of the Land and Water Conservation Fund. When that program was established a half century ago, 60% of all the land was supposed to go into the state and local funds. Those are the programs that your constituents are calling you and saying these are the good things and why this program should be reauthorized. But when that cap was taken off, the amount of money going to state and local programs was reduced to the time of the Obama administration. It was down to 12%. Everything else was for land acquisition. This bill reforms that permanently by saying no less than 40% has to go to those state and local funds that your constituents like. No less than 3% has to go to fulfilling facility recreation access. That means that we are, for the first time now, really empowering people and communities, state and local governments, as well as sportsmen. Look, I've always said that I want to shrink the federal estate. This bill finally does shrink the federal estate in my state as well as nationwide. We create 4 new monuments in this bill, but the right way, not expecting a president to make a declaration, but actually for the Congress to pass a bill, to debate the bill, and then to pass the bill at the same time. This administration actually did use the Antiquities Act on one of these monuments, nice and cute, but we're going to do it the right way in this particular bill. We're going to do wilderness the right way. No longer should an agency simply create wilderness by dicta or by fiat. Congress will make those decisions of what is wilderness and what is not going to be wilderness. Let me talk for just a second about wilderness because it has some controversy in here. Over half the wilderness that is established in this section of bills is in my home state of Utah. But as Mr. Curtis will tell you, the county commissioners, the local officials, endorse this action. They are happy with it because they gain access to other areas that can promote recreation and economic development, which they have been trying to get for several decades. A quarter of this is also in California, in one district. So we create wilderness in the national park, but at the same time, we're taking wilderness study areas and releasing those. At the same time, we are making exchanges so that some of the lands go into trust funds for education purposes to fund the education of our kids, something the East doesn't need, but those of us who live in the federally controlled West, we desperately need to do that. For the first time, we are taking EJIA, and we're actually going to have some transparency so we will really know what it costs for environmental litigation. These are all issues we have been talking about for years in the House. These are issues that we repeatedly passed in the House. But for now, we have a chance of actually making it happen. Is this bill perfect? No. It's too big to be perfect. Is the process for creating this perfect? Hell no. But I am perfectly satisfied and willing to vote for this because without this, there will be no progress. The status quo will be maintained, and that is bad. Look, Senator Graham used to say, if I'm going from Washington back to Houston, I get as far as Memphis, that's not bad. If I end up in Boston, it's bad. But for Memphis, that's not necessarily bad. We have been complaining for years about elements that are in this package of bills, and now we have a chance to actually be positive, to get to Memphis and beyond, to actually get something done. And if someone says it's not good enough, I'm holding out for something better, we are holding out for something that never has been and never will be. And the lie, and it puts to the lie the complaints that we have exaggerated in the past. Congress is finally ready to act. We should not refuse the solutions that are in front of us right now. This is a step forward, and this obviously is better than the alternatives. I urge adoption of this package of compromise bills that have been worked out in advance, and I appreciate my colleagues on the Democrat side who worked so hard to try and come up with a package of bills that we can all support. With that, I yield back, but I reserve the balance of our time.
Gentleman from Utah reserves the balance of